Good evening, and welcome to the Law Alumni Association's Annual Fall Conference. I am Rocco Andreola, President of the Alumni Association, and I'm delighted to be here with you tonight. This evening's program represents an exciting first for the Fall Conference. The Law Alumni Association is pleased to announce that tonight's event is being co-sponsored with the Law School's Journal of Legislation and Public Policy. Under this new format for the Fall Conference, the Alumni Association will partner with and co-sponsor this event with a different journal each year. We view this as a perfect opportunity to have both our alumni and students work together, and I'm extremely proud of this wonderful collaboration. Thank you to our distinguished panelists and to all of you for joining us here tonight. And you're invited to continue our discussion on this wonderful topic at a reception immediately following the panel, and the reception will be set up in the back. I would like to express my gratitude to all the members of the Fall Lecture Committee, particularly the co-chairs who are here with us tonight, Alan Klinger, Karen Schulman, and Norman Green, as well as Peter Dabrowski, Doug Lindner, and Will Brewer, who are all here from the Journal of Legislation and Public Policy. Thank you to all of you for recognizing the importance of tonight's topic and for partnering together to bring us such wonderful experts in the field. And as you can see from this incredible turnout tonight, the Fall Lecture Committee and the Journal definitely picked a clear winner. And last, but definitely not least, I want to recognize and thank Professor Rick Pildes for serving as our moderator and leading the effort to assemble this all-star panel. Finally, it gives me great pleasure to turn the proceedings over to the new Dean of NYU Law School, Trevor Morrison. Trevor, thank you for joining us tonight at what I know will be your first of many fall conferences to come. And we are thrilled that you could be here, and we look forward to working closely with you in the future.
Thanks, Rocco, and good evening, everyone. I do want to thank Rocco, not just for that introduction, but for the tremendous work he's done leading the Law Alumni Association. I hope you'll join me in thanking Rocco now for that tremendous work. And as Rocco just said, it really is a great thing this year that we are starting this collaboration between the LAA and this year the Journal of Legislation and Public Policy. I'm grateful to both for their work in making tonight's event possible, and I agree that we're starting a tremendous tradition here of collaboration that'll draw together our students and our alums in future years. I think it's just terrific. This is one of those ideas that's so good that as soon as you see it happen, you have no idea why no one thought of it until now. But I think the future really is very exciting for this collaboration. This is, obviously, my first Law Alumni Association lecture, but just a quick review of its history confirms the spectacular array of interesting topics that have been taken up by terrific people over the past several years. Last year's session, as many of you will remember, was moderated by University Professor Arthur Miller. It brought together leading experts in sports, business, law, and media to debate issues relating to the regulation of college athletics. The year before that, Professor Kathy Strandberg moderated a discussion between consumer protection and technology experts about tracking technology and consumer privacy. These are incredibly important issues, obviously, and of great interest to our community. And this year's topic is no different. The future of voting rights in the United States could not be more timely or important. And our panelists could not be better situated to explore this issue in depth with us tonight. I want to thank all of them for being here tonight. I'm really looking forward to the discussion. I want to join Rocco in thanking in particular my colleague Rick Pildes, the Sudler Family Professor of Constitutional Law. Rick, as many of you know, is himself deeply expert in the issues that will be taken up tonight, and I think it's great that he's going to moderate the discussion this evening. But my formal task really is to introduce Peter Dabrowski, the Editor-in-Chief of the Journal of Legislation and Public Policy, so a few words about Peter. He's a third-year law student in our JD program here, and will be joining Cleary Gottlieb, Steen, and Hamilton after graduating. Before arriving at the law school, he studied journalism, political science, and philosophy at the University of Missouri, from which he graduated summa cum laude. Peter has been a real leader in the law school during his time here on a range of fronts. In addition to his work with the journal, he served on the steering committee of the Public Interest Law Center annual auction and on the board of the NYU chapter of the American Constitution Society. Of greatest significance and greatest trepidation for a dean, Peter is also the producer of this year's NYU Law Review, UE. So to close, let me just say that if warmth of welcome has any ability to encourage merciful treatment of the dean, then I hope Peter will consider this a warm, warm welcome. Join me in welcoming Peter Dabrowski.
So on the list of things that I thought would happen during law school, being introduced by the dean was not one of them. Thank you very much, Dean Morrison. First, I'd like to echo Rocco, the Law Alumni Association, and everyone in alumni relations enthusiasm at the prospect of this new ongoing relationship. The Journal of Legislation and Public Policy is excited to publish the proceedings of this evening's event in our summer issue and to see where this relationship will lead in years to come. And I know we speak for the entire journal staff and for the student body at large in saying that we're honored to be the first people to share the stage. Shelby County versus Holder changed this country. And as soon as the decision came down, the Journal of Legislation and Public Policy knew that we wanted to hold an event exploring the ramifications of this landmark decision on voting rights and election law in America. And as we started planning this evening, we heard one line repeatedly from every person we asked. You cannot hold this event, you cannot discuss Shelby County without Rick Pildes. And for the record, we were thinking the same thing, but we were delighted to get confirmation and to partner with the Law Alumni Association Fall Conference Committee to make this forum a reality. Professor Richard Pildes is one of, if not the nation's leading scholars in public law, credited in many ways with the creation of the field of law study that we at NYU take for granted as the law of democracy, enriched by our fantastic relationship with the Brennan Center for Justice, a representative of whom will be speaking tonight. He's such a name in this field that he's actually become sort of a public figure, Emmy nominated, in fact, for his televised legal analysis of the 2000 presidential election and its famous post-mortem litigation. The seminal casebook he wrote with Professor Isakharov, also on the panel this evening, The Law of Democracy, is widely considered to be the authority on election law, consulted by students, practitioners, and the Supreme Court alike, and I should note, taught by President Barack Obama during his time at the University of Chicago Law School. His op-eds and commentary appear regularly and recently in such papers of record as the New York Times and the Wall Street Journal. And his scholarship graces such flagship publications as the Harvard Law Review, scholarship which just this week led to him being elected to the American Law Institute. Perhaps most pertinent to this evening, however, Professor Pildes is an outstanding teacher. The effusive praise of those who've been privileged enough to learn under him and his infectious passion for the law of free and fair elections, the law of democracy, the heart of tonight's discussion, is testament enough to that. The law school is lucky to have him, as are we. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my honor to introduce Professor Richard Pildes.
Welcome to you all, and thanks very much to Peter for that introduction. I think I should be clear to say a couple of things in response to the introduction. First, Peter is not currently a student of mine. So unlike the dean, he can't be accused of trying to ingratiate himself with someone who holds power over him at the moment. The second is that we're very fortunate that my colleague and good friend Sam Isakharov was able to join this panel at the last minute. Sam has been overseas and in a case discussion in Philadelphia today as well. We weren't sure if he would be able to make it back. So the fact that Peter focused on me is, I think, a product of his having written his remarks before we knew Sam would be here. So let me just say that everything that Peter said could have been said about Sam equally. We've been equal partners in this venture for a long time. There are two broad set of issues that we're going to talk about here tonight concerning voting rights issues today in the United States and going forward. The first is the constant embarrassment we seem to have with respect to our voting systems in elections. This time around, in the 2012 election, it was these embarrassingly long lines, 7 to 8 hours or so, in places like Virginia and Florida. The question is, why can't we get this right, especially in a country that seems to be very good at delivering mass volume consumer services in the private sector? And the second issue we're going to focus on is the one that Peter mentioned in his remarks, which is the Supreme Court's recent very high-profile decision in this case called Shelby County, decided this past June. Shelby County held that a part of the Voting Rights Act that had been in place since 1965 was unconstitutional. Section 5 had singled out particular states and counties in the country, mostly in the South, and placed them under a unique regime of federal control in which they could not change anything about their voting systems without getting federal approval. So what are the likely consequences of this decision? What are the consequences being felt already? And if Congress is going to respond to the court's decision by getting back into the picture, whether now or at some point down the road, what are the forms, at least ideally, that legislation to protect the right to vote ought to take today? As the introducers have said, we could not have a better panel in the United States to discuss these issues than the people who are here this evening. I'm not going to introduce them all at once at the beginning, because I think by the time I got to the third, you would have tuned me out. So I'm going to introduce our first two speakers initially. They're going to speak for no more than 10 minutes each initially, and then I'll introduce the other speakers. So with respect to Bob Bauer and Ben Ginsburg, who are going to speak first, you might remember that in his election night victory speech, President Obama said, "We've got to fix that." And that was the problem of these extremely long lines that were displayed in photos throughout the world. President Obama then created a presidential commission on election administration to fix that problem. And Bob and Ben are the co-chairs of that commission, which is due to report back to the president with the commission's recommendations in a couple of months now, I think. By universal consensus, Bob and Ben are the two most respected and two of the most experienced lawyers working on election issues for the two major political parties in the United States. Bob was the general counsel to the Obama campaign in both 2008 and 2012, the White House counsel to President Obama for a period of time. He's regularly listed on these lists of most influential lawyers in the United States, but also separate lists, because they're not the same, best lawyers in the United States. And NYU students and my colleagues on the faculty are very fortunate that Bob has become a distinguished scholar and in residence and senior lecturer here at NYU and on the NYU faculty. Ben Ginsburg has virtually the same credentials and experience and accolades, except that Ben was general counsel to the losing campaign in 2012 for Mitt Romney. But Bob cannot lord that over Ben quite as much as he might like, because Ben was also the general counsel to the winning Bush-Cheney campaigns in 2000 and 2004. President Obama issued an executive order that defines what the mission of this commission is. If there are any two people who can generate bipartisan agreement on reforms to fix that, the voting system and these line issues, with credibility that will be respected on both sides of the aisle. It's Bob and Ben. So it's an incredible pleasure that they've agreed to appear here in public tonight. Bob will speak first, and then Ben, and then I'll introduce the other panelists. Bob.
Thank you very much. I appreciate the invitation to be here, and I'm very pleased always when I'm able to be here on the campus at NYU. Two quick introductory remarks. I came here because Rick Pildes and Sam Zakharoff and their colleagues are the leading scholars and really opinion molders in the field of the law and democracy. To me, it was very simple. This was the place where I knew people who were always really generating the most interesting debate and turning out the scholarship that frankly was driving that debate. And so I'm very grateful always to be with Rick and Sam. Second, I've been often asked, since I'm in Washington, I commute back and forth, to integrate as much as possible to the NY community when I'm here. And so having heard tonight for the first time that there's a NYU review, which apparently I take it is in the tradition of sort of satiric reviews, I wanted Peter to know that I am more than happy to participate and play Ben Ginsburg. If you notice, we both have beards, and I think I can make this work very well. In any event, on the subject of the commission, Ben will speak, obviously, from his perspective and talk a little bit more about the charges under the executive order that the president issued, pursuant to which the commission was established. I want to make a few preliminary observations, influenced somewhat, though we can't talk about where we're headed as a commission right now. We're not there yet. We're still collecting information. We've completed the public hearings. We're engaging in some fact-finding. We'll be slowly engaged in extensive deliberation on what our recommendations will be. But my comments here will still be necessarily influenced by what we have seen to date in our travels around the country and in our conversations with a wide variety of scholars, experts, groups, and frankly, the general public. At every public meeting, we have what Ben calls open mic, where the public comes forward and also offers perspectives as voters and as associations and communities representing voters on the electoral process. And I want to simply talk about what lines mean in "we shall fix that," because it's not the only issue that we're addressing, but in some respects, it's quite representative. And then take it to what is changing potentially in the field of election administration as far as we can tell, or I should speak for myself, as far as I can tell from what we have learned so far in the commission. Lines are a problem where they occur. There's no question about it. And it came to the attention of the press and to the voting public and to the political parties and candidates and eventually to the president, who raised it on election night and then came back to it in the State of the Union address. But lines are one of a number of problems, and in some respects, there are a variety of issues in the electoral process that contribute to lines. It's not a, if you will, unicausal phenomenon. Lines can be a product of mismanagement of the polling place. They can be a product of a well-managed polling place, but very heavy flow and a very long ballot that it takes a considerable time for voters to read through. It can be also a function of problems with resources, either inadequate resources or problems with the way the resources are deployed, as with both limited machinery and maybe machinery that isn't functioning the way that it should. So in many respects, lines seem simple, but lines also is an example of an issue that is actually sufficiently complicated, and it brings into the discussion a range of questions about the quality of election administration in the United States. And what we are discovering as we go around the country, I think it is fair to say, speaking again for myself, but I don't believe all or even many of my colleagues on the commission would disagree, is that there is remarkable, in a country that is sort of polarized and divided on some issues, there is remarkable agreement between parties and among the various stakeholders about some of the fundamental problems that have affected the electoral process and that really impede the full exercise of the franchise by voters, that disrupt the voting experience. And that is somewhat reassuring to us, obviously, because it means that we have had testimony, we've been hearing from people in an environment that has been remarkably free of some of the political conflicts that we see raging elsewhere, that's been very focused on substance, very focused on facts, very focused on management and other best practices, that can focus just on the question of election administration as public administration and see the voting experience improved by better public administrative practices. But part of what's driving this is voter expectation across the country, Democratic, Republican, Independent, or none of the above. Voters, after all, live a certain way in our world. They live, as Rick said just a few minutes ago, they live in a world in which they are used to having the goods and the services that are provided to them provided a certain way. Just the other day, we read about Amazon entering into an agreement with the United States Postal Service to begin delivering packages on Sunday. This is a country now where people expect speed and efficiency and convenience. And that's catching up with the electoral process, a system that once might not have necessarily put so much emphasis on what we call customer service is beginning to do more of that. And professionalism in the provision of this customer service is becoming much more of a watchword, and it has had a considerable amount to do with the way the commission, in fact, everything to do with the way the commission was constructed by the president. It consists of, with the exception, Ben and I like to say, of the two political hacks at the top, below us are experts in election administration and senior executives of companies that have built a reputation, or whose executives have built a reputation of being very attentive to ways in which to better to deliver the services within their industry. And so there may be here a development in the culture that's beginning to merge with what we expect just as a matter of democratic theory. What we think about the right to vote and how it should be delivered might well slowly but surely be undergirded by and powered forward by broader developments in what voters as citizens expect of the voting process in the same way as they expect it in other aspects of their lives. So with those introductory remarks, let me turn it over to Ben.
Good evening. First of all, thank you very much for having me here to discuss the first of your issues on the panel about the work of the Presidential Commission. And it's a special treat to be up here with my very good-looking colleague, Bob Bauer, to talk about this. And it really has been a pleasure and a joy to travel around the country to deal with these issues that are essentially the nonpartisan issue of all legally permissible voters being able to cast their ballots without undue hardships or accessibility issues. And it's a very important bipartisan issue. So I do appreciate the opportunity for us to be able to talk further about it with all of you. It is, let me also echo what Bob says about NYU and about Rick and Sam and the program that they've put together here. It really is a terrific program that really has benefited not only thought and critical thinking in the area, but also all the students who get to take their courses. So it's particularly great to be here on this panel. Bob mentioned that the president, in his executive order, charged us with looking at a number of issues. Long lines was certainly the marquee issue, and a problem, as Bob noted, that we've addressed. We're also looking at such things as poll workers and the recruitment and training of them, really an interesting and challenging problem around the country. Voting accessibility for uniformed and overseas voters, the notion that people serving overseas or living overseas should have undue hardships in casting their votes is as antithetical as barriers at a polling place to being able to vote. We're looking at voter rolls and poll books, clean registration rolls, the poll books that are actually used in the polling place. There's certainly an overlay with the long line issue on the ability to move people through in an easy and coherent fashion. Voting machine capacities. You all here in New York in your primary had to use lever machines, which, honest to God, we thought were done and gone after Florida, but it was great to see them kind of resurrected for your primary here. But there is an issue I'll talk a little bit about on machines. Ballot simplicity, ballot design, provisional ballots, absentee ballots, the adequacy of contingency plans for national disasters. So that's a pretty full plate of issues in terms of people being able to go into polling places and cast and count their ballots. Bob mentioned our commission, and it really is a group that I think has given us considerable insights. The five professional election administrators, and then the private sector folks. We have the vice president of theme parks at Disney on our panel, because who knows how to deal with lines better than Disney. Bob trying to hold deliberative meetings in Dumbo's Flying Circus was really kind of something to behold, but it goes with the territory. They have some very good techniques for moving people through. We have a Deloitte Touche, the chief executive officer in North America, who is on our panel, and the general counsel of the New York Public Library, who was formerly the general counsel at Allstate. And these folks, plus the five state and local election administrators, really have given the two political hacks a great deal of insight on the issue. So to frame up a little bit what we've seen as we've gone about, and Bob mentioned that we're still going through the process of deciding the precise recommendations that we'll make or best practices. If you were going to design a voting system for a country, it would not be what we have in the United States. That's a fundamental issue. There are over 8,000 jurisdictions with over 8,000 individuals who have some sort of authority in and of themselves about the way ballots are cast and counted. You will be surprised to know, after we've gone around the country and met with many, many state and local election officials, that the quality is somewhat uneven between them. And so if you're looking for similar ballots being able to be cast and counted the same way, there is an inherent issue to be dealt with in the fact that there are over 8,000 jurisdictions with independent authority. Our polling places, the folks who go out and serve the polling places on election days are volunteers. They're not professionals. They work maybe 2 days a year, really more likely 2 days every other year. And that's not a whole lot of training, and the amount of training that they get generally amounts to a couple of hours. And to deal with many of the problems on the list that I mentioned, that's something that we have to deal with. Bob touched on the technology. The technology has not come close to keeping up with where we are today as a society in terms of the machines. Not only that, it's extremely difficult for election officials to find machines with which they're satisfied in terms of their capabilities. We have not met one election official who has said to us, "We love our voting system. It is a terrific voting system. It does everything we want." Not one. We've talked to the machine manufacturers. Why don't you make better machines? The answer is the market is so diverse, because there are over 8,000 jurisdictions, that it's tough to be able to sell to the market. And on top of that, we have a certification process for new technology that was written in 2005 and can't be updated, because under the current statutory scheme, certification is left to the Election Assistance Commission, a body that has zero of its five commissioners filled, no nominations in the pipeline, and no appetite in Congress to name the commissioners. So even if a locality wants to find a new technology, there are sort of inherent problems in the system. So that's some of the fun that Bob and I are having. We look forward to reading our report as much as you do. And thank you again for having us here. And it really is an issue that Bob and I, as partisan hacks who first met on opposite sides of a House recount in 1982, are determined to make a bipartisan effort to try and make this situation of casting and counting ballots better. Thank you.
So let me briefly introduce the next two speakers. I'm trying to adhere to my rule that you can only absorb a couple at a time. Myrna Perez will speak first. She's the deputy director of the Brennan Center. Many of you may know, but some of you who don't should know, that the Brennan Center is an independent institution that's strongly affiliated with the law school. It has become one of the central organizations in the United States for work, litigation, policy work on voting rights and related issues. Myrna is the deputy director of that part of the Brennan Center, so she'll speak first. And then Dale Ho, who is the director of the ACLU's Voting Rights Project, will speak next. Dale's testified on election reform issues to legislatures around the country. He's an adjunct professor of law at Brooklyn and New York law schools. He's published a number of significant academic articles in this area, and he will tell you about some of the work the ACLU is involved in currently with respect to voting rights. So Myrna, turn it over to you.
Bienvenidos, welcome all alumni and students. In addition to being at the Brennan Center, which is proudly affiliated with NYU, I'm also an adjunct professor here, and I have to say it is very encouraging and heartwarming to be in a conversation that has both former professors and current students in the same room. I want to discuss two particular things with respect to the trend of the future of voting rights acts. I first want to look at legislative trends so we can see what state legislatures around the country are doing. And then I want to look at some on-the-ground activity. It's really important to remember that going into 2012, there was a very predominant narrative. And that was all across the country, state legislatures were rushing to try and pass legislation that would restrict voting rights. This was something that was indeed very significant. We had more than 180 bills that would restrict voting rights in some ways be introduced in over 41 state legislatures. These kinds of restrictions took many forms. They included cutbacks to early voting, really stringent photo identification laws, restrictions on rights for people with criminal convictions, requiring a documentary proof of citizenship in order to be able to register to vote. They imposed barriers on community groups trying to register voters, and they put other kinds of barriers in front of the ballot box. And when all of the dust had settled, we had had more than 25 laws and two executive actions pass in more than 19 states that would have made it harder for Americans to vote. But that was not what many voters experienced on Election Day, and that was because a great number of people, including people on this panel, stepped in and stepped up on behalf of voters. We had voters repealing legislative acts. We had the Department of Justice stepping in some cases. We had individual organizations and voters defend against some of these restrictions. And on Election Day, we had far fewer of these restrictions in place actually affecting what voters experienced. The 2013 experience was considerably different. There, we only had 90 restrictive legislation be introduced in states across the country, and only in 33 of those states. Now, 90 is half of what we saw. Granted, it's still not done. There are still some legislatures that are still open. We're worried about some bills being passed in Ohio and some other places, but it looks very different when you compare that to the positive and expansive legislation that we've seen be considered. We have had 243, at least, pieces of legislation that would expand access to the ballot box be introduced in 45 states. Now, introduction is not a perfect measure of where the country is going. We certainly know that. And when you look at what the passage rate, there's more parity, right? We had about 8 states pass 9 restrictive bills, and 10 states pass 13 bills that would expand the franchise. But there's a couple of things that we can take from this. Cynically, we can take the fact that many of the state legislatures that intend to pass restrictive legislation have already done so. There's an opportunity in that, right? Because now we can focus on the kinds of bipartisan bills that might allow for more voters to have access. And we saw some of this in a state like Virginia, which passed both restrictive legislation and expansive legislation. But it also means that we need to continue the effort to make restricting the right to vote toxic. There are many, many people that have responded to these restrictions on the right to vote and have stood up for those rights and are insisting that legislatures listen to them and that legislators do their part in making sure that we have a free and fair election system. And I think it's really, really important that we have a clear-eyed view about what is at stake and what we can expect to see in the future. When we're looking at threats and opportunities, we do have to remember that in many states, we are under a different regime. As Rick indicated, the Shelby County decision could potentially be a game changer in a number of ways because we don't have what has been universally hailed as the most effective piece of protection against discrimination in voting. And that means that some jurisdictions which had previously been prevented from implementing discriminatory voting practices are going to have less burdens and less hurdles to face in doing that. And in this new world, it's a little bit too early to say that we've seen trends, because as Rick noted, the Shelby County decision only came in June. But there are some observations, there are some things that we can look at on the ground and see that the practice of elections are going to be different, and the jurisprudence around election law is going to change, and I know that many of my panelists are going to be discussing this more at length. So I'll only look at a few observations, and again, these are observations because we're not going to be able to decide that there are any trends until more time have passed. But one thing that I think is something worth observing is whether or not we were right about many of the things that Section 5 did. For example, one of the primary reasons why people thought Section 5 was so effective was because it prevented case-by-case litigation where you'd have situations in which discriminatory practice was prohibited in one instance and then it would come up in another. Justice Ginsburg called it a multi-headed hydra. And we would, there's a lot of resources and time and effort that is being spent in this kind of litigation to try and stop these kinds of discriminatory practices. In two states for which that were formerly covered by Section 5 in North Carolina and in Texas, there's been a major piece of legislation that's being challenged, and there's been a bunch of lawsuits. There's no fewer than four lawsuits happening in North Carolina to challenge the same omnibus legislation, and I know Dale's gonna talk about this more. And there's no fewer than three in Texas at the moment, and I'm not even including those that have already been consolidated. So the idea of having a mechanism like Section 5 to prevent the waste of resources from having to take a hold and have extra litigation is something that the history might prove that we were right about that. Another interesting thing to observe is how other tools in the Voting Rights Act are going to be used. There is a little known provision of the Voting Rights Act, sometimes called the pocket trigger or the bail-in provision. And what it does is allow a court to subject someone to preclearance. And it can be done in a variety of fashions. It's a case-by-case basis, and it's used as a form of relief. It's called 3C relief. Some of the studies on this have indicated that this has been sparingly used in the past, and it makes sense, right? We had Section 5, so we didn't need to be pulling in a bunch of jurisdictions, some of the worst offenders with this other pocket trigger. But in 2010, there was a study published in the Yale Law Journal. It's a great, it's like the great treatise on the bail-in provision that indicated since 1972, we've had nine jurisdictions bail in. So nine jurisdictions since 1972 be subject to the preclearance provision through the pocket trigger. Thus far, it's only a few months after Shelby County, we've had at least six cases request this kind of relief. Now, we don't know if all of them are going to get it, and some of these cases are repetitive in asking for them, but we could possibly observe that some of the jurisprudence around voting rights is going to be focusing a lot on this pocket trigger. And the other observation, which again is too early to call a trend, is the Department of Justice is not the first one in some of these cases. The Department of Justice had an incredibly important role under the preclearance regime. It was the one that was responsible for the administrative procedure. defendants did have the option of going to the court system, but the vast majority of cases were decided through the DOJ's administrative procedure. But now that we have no functioning Section 5, there are a lot of private groups that are out there filing these cases first, and then the Department of Justice is having to come in. We could have lots of questions about strategies regarding races to the courthouse and the importance of trying to make sure you build a record and those sorts of things. But I think the question and the role of the DOJ is something that we all should be looking at. And then finally, there is, unfortunately, increasing evidence that the kinds of changes that we thought would happen that would be pernicious and harmful to minority voters are, in fact, going to happen. So, for example, the concern that there would be jurisdictions that would try to revive changes that were blocked by Section 5 previously. Now that there's no Section 5, they would run ahead with it. We've had Texas. Texas is a case that I'm involved in, and their photo ID law was stopped through the preclearance process, and now they're implementing it. We've had cases where Section 5 was thought to have deterred private bad acts. In North Carolina, their omnibus bill has a number of different components, which Dale will definitely talk about, but one of the legislator leaders said, effectively, we were just going to pass a photo ID bill, but now that we don't have Section 5, we thought we'd load it up. We've had bills that have lain dormant that are now being revived. In Alabama, they had passed a photo identification law, they had subjected it to preclearance, and they withdrew it. And then now Shelby County happened. It had never been blocked because they withdrew it, and now it's being enacted. And we expect to see these kinds of changes happening more and more often. And it's especially important to remember when we combine that with legislative trends, I need 2 seconds. When we combine that with legislative trends, many of the former Section 5 jurisdictions don't have active legislatures right now, but they will. In January, we can expect that 10 of the former jurisdictions that were used to be subject to Section 5 will now have new legislatures, and we need to watch what they're doing.
Thanks, Mary. Dale?
Thank you so much for having me here tonight. It's really an honor to appear on a panel with such a distinguished group of speakers. I'm going to talk very briefly about how we can expect the world to be different after Shelby County in one respect. And I want to try to address that issue through two questions. What did litigation look like under Section 5? And now what is voting litigation going to look like without Section 5? So just to briefly recap and make sure I think everyone has a good sense of what Section 5 is, but just to briefly recap, it required certain jurisdictions with the worst histories of discrimination in voting in the country to obtain preclearance or approval before implementing any changes to their voting laws, either from the Department of Justice or from a district court in Washington, D.C. Now, those jurisdictions can implement those changes to their voting laws, and they can only be challenged by victims of discrimination after the fact, perhaps after a tainted election has occurred. So what did litigation look like under Section 5? I want to talk about this through the lens of two high-profile cases from 2012, which I had the privilege of participating in small ways, litigation over Texas's voter ID law and litigation over cutbacks to Florida's early voting period. And I want to give a couple of caveats before I talk about this. These two cases, although they're pretty interesting, I think, aren't really that representative of how of the bulk of what Section 5 actually did. Most laws that were stopped under Section 5 were not statewide election laws, but actually were laws adopted at the county or local level. 80% of Section 5 objections issued by the Department of Justice, for instance, were not to statewide election laws. And most Section 5 activity actually occurred in the redistricting context rather than in the registration or ballot access context. These are these kinds of cases are referred to sometimes in the academic literature as vote dilution cases as opposed to vote denial cases. That is, they're cases that concern the weight of voting power that minority communities have under a particular redistricting arrangement and whether that redistricting arrangement is fair to a minority community. I'm going to talk about a different kind of case, vote denial cases, which are about basic access to registration and the ballot itself. But I want to focus on these cases, even though they're not all that representative of Section 5's work, because they're high-profile cases. I think they draw a lot of attention. They affect a lot of people, maybe tens of thousands or even hundreds of thousands of voters. And unfortunately, I think as Myrna referred to earlier, these kinds of suppressive voter laws unfortunately appear to be the wave of the future. What Florida did with its early voting period has been replicated this year, unfortunately, in North Carolina. Texas's voter ID law, which was blocked under Section 5, was replicated in Texas after Section 5 was struck down, and unfortunately in some other places. And these kinds of challenges, these kinds of laws seem to have a larger effect on minority voters. So the Florida early voting case, that was a case in which Florida sought to reduce its early voting period from 14 days to 8 days, including eliminating early voting on the last Sunday before Election Day, right? Now, in the 2008 election, over half of African-American voters in Florida utilized the early voting period as compared to about a quarter of white voters. And in particular, on Sunday, the last Sunday before the election, African-American voters made up over a third of the electorate. The evidence in that case showed that for some voters with difficult schedules, the choice really is between voting early or not voting at all. And the court determined that this burden fell disproportionately on minority voters, African Americans in particular, and initially blocked it. Eventually, Florida was permitted to go ahead, and I'm eliding some of the details here just for the sake of simplicity, but Florida was ultimately permitted to reduce the number of early voting days so long as it maintained the same number of early voting hours. So the early voting period got truncated, but the number of hours on which people could vote during the early voting period actually expanded. Well, how did that work out for Florida? Florida experienced the longest wait times in the country on Election Day in 2012, with many people casting ballots after the president's victory speech. Civil engineer at Ohio State University calculated that in his estimation, 200,000 voters gave up in Florida due to frustration with the lines, which were admittedly not due to the cut in early voting alone, but may have contributed to it. And one study by a professor at Reed College, Paul Gronke, who's maybe the leading expert on early voting in the country, concluded that there was substantial drop-off amongst African-American voters in 2008 who used the early voting period as compared to all other voters in 2012. So even with Section 5, we experienced some problems. Texas's voter ID law is another example. This is the law that permits you to vote in person only if you have one of a very limited forms of government-issued photo ID. So a state-issued driver's license, you're good. A state-issued concealed weapons permit, you're good. A state-issued student ID card from the University of Texas, not so good, right? So if the issue is fraud, you know, and the issue is we need to make sure these people have been identified properly by the state, the law doesn't make all that much sense if the law is intended to instead try to change the shape of the electorate. It starts to make a little bit more sense. So here's what the evidence in that case showed. One-third of counties in Texas don't have a Department of Public Safety, which is their equivalent of a DMV, which issues state-issued IDs, which meant that for some Texans, it meant a round trip of over 100 miles to get to one of these offices in order to obtain an ID. These kinds of burdens fell disproportionately on poor voters, and minorities voters in Texas are disproportionately poor. So the Texas photo ID law was blocked by the federal district court under Section 5. So what is this kind of litigation going to look like without Section 5? I think it's going to differ in at least four respects. First, the problem is going to be bigger and badder and in more places. Myrna referred to North Carolina, which had been considering a voter ID bill at the time of the Shelby County decision. The week that the Supreme Court struck down Section 5, a state senator in North Carolina said, now we can go forward with the full bill. So instead of just voter ID, they followed Florida's footsteps and cut their early voting period by a week. They ended same-day registration, which is a method of access which about 10 states in the country have. Those states have, on average, 10 percentage points higher turnout than states that don't have same-day registration. They ended pre-registration for teenagers and a host of other not-so-goodies, baddies, I guess that's what I would call them. So we have now we're litigating more issues than we were litigating before. It would have just been voter ID. Now it's this monster bill. We see things like Arizona implementing a dual registration system, where if you use the federal voter registration form in Arizona, you will be permitted to vote in federal elections, but not in state elections. You actually have to use a separate form now in order to do that. The last state that had a dual registration system was Mississippi. It enacted it in the 1890s. It did so specifically with the express purpose of making it harder for African Americans to vote. So Arizona is reviving sort of an ignominious history in terms of dual registration systems, and it's been replicated by another state. Kansas is now doing it too. So we have a bigger and badder problem. Second problem, timing of the remedy is different. Obviously, before Section 5 blocked laws before they were implemented, now we have to litigate after the fact. And the speed of these cases is going to be quite different. When Texas and Florida sought to implement these changes to their voting laws, they were given expedited litigation schedules out of due respect for state sovereignty. I can guarantee you when plaintiffs are challenging these laws, we will not get the same level of deference from courts when we're protecting the individual right to vote, which is apparently less valuable than state sovereignty. Third way in which these laws will be different, the burden of proof is obviously different. Texas and Florida had to prove that their laws were not discriminatory and bore the burden of proof in those cases. Now plaintiffs will have to prove that those laws are in fact discriminatory. And a fourth way in which these cases are going to be different is the substantive standard for establishing liability is quite different under Section 2 than it was under Section 5. The Florida and Texas cases were pretty simple. You show that the law imposes a burden and that that burden falls disproportionately on minority voters, and essentially you can win that case under Section 5, which prohibited laws that have a retrogressive effect on minority voters, that leave minority voters in a worse position than they were before that law. Section 2's standard is quite murkier. It prohibits laws that, under the totality of the circumstances, interact with social and historical factors such that minority voters have less opportunity to participate in the political process and elect candidates of their choice. If you are confused, don't worry, so am I. We are very confused exactly about how Section 2 is going to be applied in these kinds of vote denial cases. The standards for Section 2 in redistricting cases is actually quite clear, but the factors, the range of factors that we're going to have to show in these kinds of cases under Section 2 of the Voting Rights Act is less clear, let me put it that way. There's very little case law on this, hundreds of Section 2 cases on Westlaw and Lexis, but fewer than 40 of them deal with vote denial type schemes, and only I think 18 of them were successful. So we have an uphill battle ahead of us, but at least it's exciting. So thanks a lot for your time.
Let me then introduce our remaining three panelists. Julie Fernandez may be familiar to many of you as a famous actress, best known for her role in the BBC comedy, The Office. However, our Julie Fernandez was the, I don't know if you've been introduced that way before.
No, I haven't.
was the Deputy Assistant Attorney General for Civil Rights in the Department of Justice. Before that, she was a senior lawyer and policy analyst at the Leadership Conference on Civil Rights, which is the umbrella organization for many of the civil rights organizations in the United States. And she's now a senior policy analyst at the Open Society Foundation. Spencer Overton will speak next. I have to apologize to Spencer for having to, you know, play on someone else's court. Professor Overton is a very well-regarded, well-recognized, significant contributor as well to the field of the law of democracy and elections. He's also the director of the Political Law Studies Initiative at Georgetown Law School, where he is a professor. And he served as the... What did I say?
You said Georgetown.
Oh, GW. Which one do you prefer?
GW.
Okay, GW. He was also the principal deputy assistant attorney general at the Department of Justice in the Obama administration in the Office of Legal Policy. And last, my colleague Sam Zakharoff, who has already been introduced by Peter, because as I said, virtually all of the things that Peter said apply to Sam. For those of you who don't know Sam in the alumni group, he's also the leading scholar in the country on civil procedure and one of the leading class action lawyers in the United States. So if you have not yet called him and you work in that area, you should recognize that as part of his portfolio. Julie.
Good evening, everyone. And thank you, Rick, for the introduction and for having me here this evening. I also want to thank the Journal of Legislation and Public Policy for inviting me here, too. And it's a privilege to be here with my colleagues, many of whom I talk to a lot. So I'm going to talk about the Voting Rights Act. I'm going to talk about what I think we lost. I'm going to talk about what I think a new Voting Rights Act could look like. And then some of the challenges that we have with both Congress and the courts in being able to enact something and sustain it that would actually fill the gap left after we lost Shelby County. Now, my colleagues have talked a bit already about sort of what we lost, but I want to kind of frame it a little bit for purposes here. So when we lost preclearance, we didn't, I mean, technically for the lawyers, we lost what was unconstitutional is the coverage formula that determines which jurisdictions are subject to the preclearance mechanism. So we still have preclearance, it still exists as a procedure, but there's nothing being fed into it. There are no jurisdictions identified that have to do this. So when we lost that, we essentially lost the preclearance all the way around. The main thing that Section 5 did is it stopped discrimination from being implemented. It stopped voting changes that were discriminating from being, that were discriminatory, from applying ahead of time. Why is that such a big deal? Because post hoc remedies don't work very well in our world. In the world of elections, as you all know who work in elections, once an election happens, it's over. No one cares. Right? They only care to the extent you can establish that whatever went wrong actually affected the outcome. How hard is that to establish? Very. When the wrong that happened were that people were deterred from, denied, particularly on the issues of effectiveness of the vote, this is an impossible, almost impossible thing to establish. So elections, unlike employment discrimination or housing discrimination, there's no money. You're not going to pay people damages. You're not going to give them the apartment. How do you give them their democracy back after the election? You don't. So under Section 5, we had this incredible power to stop discrimination from being implemented, and we don't have that anymore. What else do we have? What did we lose? We lost notice and disclosure, friends. What am I talking about? So, under the Section 5 regime, all or part of 16 states, 25% of the country, had to submit every voting change they wanted to propose to DOJ, mostly to DOJ, sometimes to the DDC, but to DOJ, and tell them, we're gonna do this. And they had to do it ahead of time. And then a process went through where they would evaluate whether or not it was retrogressive or had a discriminatory purpose. But they had to tell them. And also part of the analysis that folks in the section in the Civil Rights Division did was to look, one of the criteria that we would look at is, have you reached out to the minority community to talk to them about this change? And we'd say, who did you talk to? Right? So there was this affirmative obligation to tell the community, to tell us, to talk to them, and to be very transparent about the process. That is gone. It's as if the lights have been turned off and we see nothing. And as Dale pointed out, 85% of the objections that were interposed by the Department of Justice since 1965 were not at the statewide level, at the local level. And I don't, it's school boards and county commissions and city councils and water districts and police juries. It's all the stuff that really, really, really matters to folks all over the country, where they live, which is almost is so often not partisan at all. It's about political power for different groups. And in some parts of the country, that breaks down along racial lines. It's so much better than it used to be. I wouldn't be standing here if it hadn't been better. But it's not, we're not there all the way. So we lost notice and disclosure, critical. Also related to that is we lost the deterrent effect. The deterrent effect of Section 5. If you know someone is looking at you when you're doing something, how likely are you to do it in a way that's kind of like stinky? Low, right? Your life's much lower. So you think, you know what, I'm going to have to tell people about this. I'm going to have to tell them why I'm doing it. I'm going to have to talk to the minority community about this. I mean, okay, let's just not do that. And I'm not making that up. I mean, I have talked to so many local legislators, local everybodies, for almost, scarily, almost 20 years in this context. And sheriffs and everybody else, and they're worried about, is this going to look okay? Should I be really doing this? Look at the transcripts when people talk about in the South Carolina voter ID case, just to take an example, because we know this has been very high profile. There were discussions in the among the legislators, but you know, how can we do this? Can we do this? Is this going to impact minority voters? They don't have to talk like that anymore, do they? Because the deterrent effect is pretty much gone because litigation is long, hard, expensive, rare. Very different. I want to give one example of the world post Section 5 to illustrate sort of a little bit at the local level about what may go on out there. What small indications we have, as Myrna says, we don't have a lot of data right now because we're kind of in this funny period before people are really ramping up for elections. But I have to mention Pasadena, Texas. Pasadena, Texas, second largest city in Harris County, Texas. Harris County is where Houston is. 150,000 people. They used to have a city council of 8 single-member districts. They did a referendum at the urging of the mayor to change it from 8 single-member districts to 6 single-member districts and 2 at-large districts, meaning that the people would be elected from the entire city. They did this in the face of a rapidly accelerating minority Latino population that's increased something like from 40-something to 60-something in 10 years. Now, their voter reg hasn't caught up, but it will. So this change, but many people are concerned that this change was done with a discriminatory purpose, and they're looking into whether it has a discriminatory effect. The mayor actually is on tape saying, well, we can do this now because DOJ doesn't have, we don't have to ask DOJ anymore. And ask DOJ anymore means we don't have to have an anti-discrimination check on what we're doing. That's what that, all that that means. Same thing with the North Carolina. So they went ahead, they had a referendum. Referendum won by 87 votes. They're now making the change. Full stop. There are folks down there trying to figure out, do they have a lawsuit? Can they afford it? Can they pay for the expert? You know, 2 years later, you might get a remedy. 2 years later. So what do we need? Because this is where I'm spending a lot of my time, is working with colleagues and talking to members of Congress about what a fix could look like. Now, one thing I'll say is that we're not, having lost the trigger, the question is not really limited to what's the new trigger. I think the question is, what is the mechanism that can protect minority voters? And can we pass it? And will the Supreme Court think it's constitutional? Now, in that last bit, I mean, who knows, right? Just to say for a second about Shelby County versus Holder, I mean, I don't know how many people have read this opinion, but it's just stunning. Because I was very involved in the reauthorization of the Voting Rights Act back in 2005 and 6. We spent all of our time worrying, Bernie, 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 right? We thought we had the 15th Amendment in our pocket, so we thought we had something, we thought we had a really strong argument that we didn't need to worry about Bernie. And we all fought with each other. Should we worry about Bernie or not? Okay, so we decided we'd worry about Bernie. So we're all about congruence and proportionality. We're all about the record. Rick Pildes testified before Congress. So did everybody else and their mother, okay? Like anyone who could find to testify, sorry, Rick, to make the record. So we're Bernie, 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 and then turns out we forgot about equal sovereignty of the states. We forgot about it. Why? Because who the hell is thinking about that? Right, the doctrine of equal sovereignty of the states, which Chief Justice Roberts says is the reason why our formula is unconstitutional, is that the cases he cites are of the three, two are from before the Civil War. I couldn't make that up. The third is from the 1890s. And the whole doctrine was developed in terms of thinking about admission of states to the Union. But that's why we lost, because of equal sovereignty of the states. So who knows what's constitutional, friends? I don't know. Very quickly, because I have no time. We're trying to figure out, do we still need preclearance? We think yes. How can we make that happen? Is there a new formula? What would it look like? If we can figure it out, it's going to be narrow. It's not going to be very broad. It's a very difficult set of questions about how we could get through this trick bag from Chief Justice Roberts that says you have to be both recent and you have to look at history. Let's figure that out. Second, we know that the Supreme Court doesn't like Congress, hates Congress, doesn't like DOJ, hates DOJ. But they love courts. So what can we do with courts, right? Can we expand 3C in the way that Mirna was talking about? Under 3C, the bail-in, the pocket trigger, you have to establish a finding of intentional discrimination before a court has the power to order a preclearance remedy. So can you expand that? Can you give courts more authority to find other types of violations of the Voting Rights Act that could be a predicate? Can you have other types of proceedings in court that would allow you to argue that certain jurisdictions should be covered by preclearance? Can we do that? Can we have some kind of notice requirements on certain jurisdictions or certain types of changes that are linked to discrimination? Can we somehow make some changes to the Voting Rights Act that will make it easier to get preliminary injunctions, make it easier to stop voting changes from being implemented, some way to help define irreparable harm differently in this context, given that we're talking about elections and the cliff? So are there things like that that we can play around with? I know I'm done, so I'm done. I've talked about the challenge of Congress. Isn't that a hornet's nest? But it always is, and I just want to say one thing, please. People talk about how, you know, the Congress is so bad and the politics is so bad. Look, there's all this bipartisanship right here. Look at this. We have all this right here. But Congress is always a hornet's nest and it's always bad. And since I've been doing this work with Congress for all these too many years, it's always bad and yucky. And when we reauthorized the Voting Rights Act in 2006, it was George Bush, Republicans in the House, Republicans in the Senate, and we did it with overwhelming votes. So don't tell me it's ugly out there. It's always ugly. The courts are a bigger problem. And I'm happy to answer questions.
Thanks, Julie.
So, good evening. I want to start off by thanking your dean, Trevor Morrison. Thank you, congratulations. Trevor was a star in the White House, and you all should be thrilled that he is your leader here. Also want to thank, and I'm just honored to be here, with Sam Zakharoff and Rick Pildes. I mean, these guys are stars, leaders in our field in terms of the textbook. They're generous with comments and with feedback. They're really stars around the world, not just in the country. You should be proud that they are yours. Also want to thank the Alumni Association and the Journal. Will Brewer, thanks for going beyond the call of duty to help me out. Now, when we talk about the future of voting rights, a group of scholars has emerged to argue that Congress should look beyond the race discrimination approach and adopt largely a race-neutral reforms for federal elections. The epicenter of this movement is right here at NYU. So for example, NYU professors Sam Zakharoff and Rick Pildes argue that instead of using the limited race-driven 15th Amendment, Congress should use its power under the Elections Clause to pass general election reform for federal elections. Sam offers what he describes as a, quote, non-civil rights vision, end of quote, that would help insulate the right to vote from naked efforts at partisan manipulation. To this end, in the aftermath of Shelby County, Sam has proposed that Congress require that states and localities disclose election changes for federal elections. Rick has made a similar argument and contemplated uniform felon voting laws and uniform identification requirements for federal elections, and they have been joined by a handful of other scholars. I understand this shift, right? Race relations have improved dramatically in the last 50 years. Our nation has elected an African-American president. The argument for general reform is that today's primary problems are barriers like long lines, other problems like partisan manipulation that affect, these things affect all Americans, the argument would go. Discrimination isn't the primary problem. Now, I agree that it's important to protect the voting rights of all Americans. I also agree with Sam and Rick that, you know, we should do what we can to include as many people as possible. But I disagree to the extent that their work suggests that in updating the Voting Rights Act, Congress should not focus on preventing voting discrimination or enforcing the 15th Amendment. Selecting between the 15th Amendment and the Elections Clause is a false choice. We can work to both prevent racial discrimination and voting in Congress, while at the same time improving election administration in the states to help all Americans. So I think there are three big reasons that I have in terms of differing with them. First is that voting discrimination persists and warrants attention. Second, generic reform for federal elections, it's not an effective tool to stop discrimination, especially in local elections for contests like school board, county commissioner, sheriff, right? Third, while generic reform that benefits all Americans seems at first to be an easier political sell in Congress, actually a Voting Rights Act that prevents discrimination attracts broader support. So my first point, discrimination persists. In many parts of the country, many whites and people of color cast ballots for different candidates along racial lines, and political operatives try to benefit from this racially polarized voting by manipulating election rules to lower the turnout or to dilute the votes of racial or language minorities. The problem's increasing in many areas, in part because of the growing number of Latino and Asian American populations that threaten the political status quo. So for example, in 2011, the Latino community passed 56% of the population in Nueces County, Texas. County officials responded by gerrymandering the election districts so that Latinos would not dominate on the county commission. Now, some people say, well, this high minority turnout, doesn't that mean that things are a lot better? Well, it's not a reason to surrender voting discrimination protections or an attempt to strengthen our protections, right? Because high turnout often triggers discrimination. In 2010, for example, African Americans in Augusta, Richmond, Georgia made up a larger percentage of turnout in November. They were 52% compared to in July, where they were only 43%. So what did the officials do? They moved the general elections from November back to July, where African-American turnout was lower. Another example, in November 2009, following rapid Latino growth, officials in Reynolds County, Texas, failed to put a single bilingual poll worker at any county polling place, despite a court order that required that they do so. 90% of Latino residents in Reynolds County speak Spanish at home. And my second argument is that generic election reform is not an effective barrier to discrimination. Some suggest that general election reform, this is the best way to protect minorities. If African Americans, for example, stand in line on average twice as long as whites, then if we can just reduce the line time, we'll be fine. The problem is that this does not stop politicians from manipulating election rules based on race. For example, a federal mandate that we have lines that are, you know, under 10 minutes nationwide would not prevent Nueces County from redrawing local election districts to diminish Latino voting strength. Even with generic federal election reform, we'd still need effective voting rights protections to ensure that state and local politicians don't abuse their discretion. Promoting broader access is critical, right? But it's distinct from the goal of preventing voting discrimination. By analogy, a tax deduction for mortgage interest, it promotes access to home ownership. That's a great thing. But separate laws are still needed to prevent banks from engaging in predatory lending. Different problems require different solutions. A generic election reform is also inadequate because it's generally limited to federal elections. The choice to move beyond racial discrimination and rely only on the Elections Clause rather than the 15th Amendment often limits these protections to federal elections. And if you look at 86% of the objections caught by Section 5 since 2000, more than 86% of them would not be stopped by federal reform. They wouldn't be disclosed under Sam's proposal to require disclosure for federal reforms. That's because many important changes, they're just not caught by federal reform. So local redistricting, changes to local candidate qualifications, changes to the number of members on a county commission here, right? So a lot of these local changes are missed, and as Julie's talked about, a lot of these go under the radar. These things we talked about, the statewide stuff you hear on Rachel Maddow or New York Times, or they attract the interest of these national groups. These places like Runnels County, Texas, though, where it's only population 11,000, people don't have money to bring a lawsuit. They're not getting the attention of national groups. Third and final point. Now, maybe we assume, hey, Congress is going to pass something that helps all Americans rather than just minorities, and therefore general reform is better. You know, you look in the affirmative action context, top 10% plan might be better than a race admission plan, at least in terms of popular support. That doesn't carry over to the voting context, though, and that's because Democrats and Republicans disagree often on general election reform. Many Republicans see early voting, election day registration, and less restrictive voter identification as partisan proposals that help Democrats invite fraud and inappropriately infringe on state power. On the other hand, both Republicans and Democrats generally agree that voting discrimination is wrong. And so in adopting in updating the Voting Rights Act in the past, Democrats and Republicans have come together in a bipartisan manner because of this. So I respect Sam and Rick, and apologies if I've oversimplified their arguments. I'm sure Sam's up next. He'll give a more nuanced version of their position, right? But I also, I also agree we need to improve voting for all Americans, and I applaud the work of Ben Ginsburg and Bob Bauer. Nevertheless, let me be very clear. In the aftermath of Shelby County, Congress should not surrender its obligation to enforce the 15th Amendment. Instead, more effectively preventing voting discrimination should be a key goal in updating the Voting Rights Act.
Thank you. Thanks, Spencer. Sam, I believe your name was mentioned. We actually have different views on this, by the way, but go ahead.
Well, let me just say thanks. And this obviously is a topic that has been a career point. I'm reminded of some of this Myrna was my student when I taught at a satellite institution of ours that we hold uptown. When Dale talks about the Mississippi dual registration, I tried that case in 1987 when it was struck down. And that was one of my early big cases, so I'm glad to hear that it still has legs. Let me put off a little bit of responding to Spencer and say some general things at the beginning. A very important social theorist once said, never let a crisis go to waste. He usually used a lot of expletives in addressing what he thought were the crises, but I'll avoid that. And let me suggest that there are three crises we face right now in our voting systems and our law of democracy. The first has to do with public administration and a loss of faith in the capacity of our public institutions to just handle the electoral system well. Part of that is what Ben and Bob are addressing through the Presidential Commission. There's just an obvious breakdown when you can get through Disney World efficiently, but you can't cast a vote down the street in Florida. But it's more than that. There's a strong belief among mostly Republicans that there is a significant problem with voter fraud in this country, and that undermines the integrity of the voting system. There's a strong belief among Democrats that there's a great deal of vote suppression in this country, which also undermines the integrity of the political system. There is surprisingly little empirical support for either claim, but that doesn't stop it from being strongly believed by each side's adherents. There's a second crisis that we face, which is that for much of the 20th century, we policed against some of the excesses of the vulnerabilities of our political system through the model of race, through the prism of race. Rick and I joke that when we teach the Law of Democracy course, a good part of it could just be called the Law of Alabama, because that's where the cases come from. And they're all race cases. And when they're not race cases, they really are race cases. So when you read Reynolds versus Sims from Alabama, the companion to Baker v. Carr, it's a race case. It just doesn't happen to look that way. And so we've dealt with the problem of voting through the vantage point of our most vulnerable groups in the society. Women, we took out of the equation early on in the 20th century. We extended the franchise to women categorically, and there was no litigation that followed from that. With black Americans, it was a constant battle, and that has defined the law of democracy. And now we are finding that the issues of the day are slightly different. We can debate how much, but they're different enough that they don't fall into the classic discrimination model that has defined so much of the law regulating the political process in this country. The third crisis we face is a loss of faith in the political process to yield results. We can't deliver public goods through our political system effectively anymore. We have gridlock in Congress. We seem to have a polarization in Congress. We have a system in which the extreme poles of each party seem to have taken control. So these three crises, if you will, sort of come together right now. And there's a sense there's something deeply wrong with the political system. Now, these three crises, I would submit to you, come from a distinct feature of American democracy which sets it apart from all other democracies and which somehow contribute, enhance, exaggerate the difficulties we're having at the moment. The first is that the US has partisan control of the election system, which means at every moment there's a temptation to change the rules, cheat a little bit, gain a little advantage, see what you can do to screw the other side. Now, that's always true in politics. That is what politics is about, right? It's us or them. You know, only one wins. And, you know, both Bob and Ben have been on the losing side of presidential elections. It's no fun. It's much better to be there for the acceptance speech. But what do other countries do? Well, in Europe, they have something called the Venice Commission, which is the European Commission that oversees new democracies. Point one of the Venice Commission, never have partisan administrators. You need independent administrators. We violate that as a matter of norm. Another question, all this business, who can vote? Why can they vote? Are they really who they claim to be? Every other country has a national ID. I'm from Argentina. It's no you know, bastion of liberalism and democracy and all. But Election Day works well. Everybody votes. We know who votes. It's no big deal. Why? You have a national ID. You go, you vote, and it's mandatory, right? Both the ID and the voting. Second problem, we have a constitution which doesn't speak about democracy. Well, there's a reason for that. We wanted to make sure that the slave states would never have to submit to federal authority. So we made everything up through judicial doctrine. One person, one vote, where's that in the Constitution? Where's any protection of the right to vote in the Constitution? We have a huge void. All modern democracies begin with constitutional protections of political parties, not in ours. We had to read it in with constitutional protections of all sorts of integrity of the election system, not in ours. And the third, we have certain practices which are anathema to all other democratic countries. Gerrymandering? You really want to let the incumbents draw their own lines? Now, how much does that contribute to the polarization? That's a matter that social scientists dispute. But even the appearance that these guys are drawing lines to keep themselves in office has got to be deeply offensive to any kind of democratic principle. So where does this take us? Well, there's a lot in this field that keeps trying to confront these issues. And let's turn just for the moment to Shelby County. And let me applaud Spencer for the greatest thing that one can do, which is to be invited to somebody else's home and immediately insult the hosts. That is life as it should be. That's the way I was raised, you know? If you don't have something bad to say, then just shut up. So here's the problem with the Voting Rights Act. And I've been a voting rights lawyer, and this was part of my upbringing. A lot of the statistics that we're hearing about 80% of the objections are at the local level and all that, those are old statistics. The Voting Rights Act, Section 5, did its heroic work initially. It was important in getting African Americans registered to vote. It did a little bit of work around language issues, but the bulk of its work was to break the back of Jim Crow South. And that it did. And now we have, instead of a one-party Democratic Jim Crow South, we have a bipartisan environment which is heavily overladen with race, but not entirely. It's a much more complicated arrangement. So that in 2006, when Congress talked about the reauthorization of Section 5, there were a lot of debates about how it should be structured. And the upshot was that Congress couldn't decide what to do, so they just left everything in place. In 2006, the Voting Rights Act was extended for 25 years. The trigger for most of the jurisdictions being covered by the Voting Rights Act, by Section 5, this is the trigger provision, which is actually Section 4, but it's all the same. The trigger was, what was the turnout in 1964? 1964. Now, this was gonna run till 2031. In 2031, the youngest person who would be eligible to vote in 1964 by 2031 would be either 85 or 88 years old, depending upon whether the state had an 18 or 21-year-old voting requirement. What that means is that most people in the country who are subject to preclearance under Section 5 are under that condition because of something that happened when the youngest person they could talk to about it is 85, 88 years old. And if you know 20-year-olds, 85-year-olds, 88 years old, 40-year-olds, they're near dead, right? All of them. So why would you want to have your political life, your legal responsibilities determined by that? So why am I skeptical about this? Well, as I said, we used to teach this course basically as the law of Alabama. But something interesting happened in the last 10 years. If we were going to call our course anything today, it would be called the Law of Ohio. Why? Because Ohio turned out to be the pivotal state in every presidential election post-2000. And because it was the pivotal state, and because, unfortunately, the experiences of Florida in 2000 taught us all too well that election rules can be manipulated, and how they're manipulated can be outcome determinative, and that you can play that card ahead of time. Playing it after the fact is nasty, ugly, and gets you in trouble, right? And gets you you know, on TV and written up, and you don't want that. So what we learned was that the rules can be manipulated, and they can be manipulated where it matters. And where does it matter? In every presidential election, ground zero is Ohio. Now, what's interesting about Ohio? Ohio is not a covered state under Section 5, has never been a covered state under Section 5. There is no formula that anybody has ever proposed that would address Ohio and some of the ridiculous regulations that came out of Ohio. But between 2006 and 2012, the most important developments in the law of democracy in this country turned out to have come from Ohio litigation, primarily in the federal courts, in the Sixth Circuit overall, although some of the cases went up to the Supreme Court, which unanimously affirmed them or refused to grant cert on them. And in these cases, what we find is that the courts are figuring out the same problems that I identified at the beginning. There's too much vulnerability in the system. There is a failure of public administration. There is the manipulation possibility for partisan reasons. And there is increased vulnerability among minority communities to all of these. And what the courts did was they fashioned a new constitutional doctrine of protection of the integrity of the vote, protection of the integrity of the electoral process against manipulation by those who are inside and have the most to gain by manipulating it. How'd they do so? They looked to, of all things, Bush v. Gore. And they said Bush v. Gore established the principle that if you manipulate the election rules and you can't defend it, you can't justify what you're doing it, and you do it post hoc or you do it in an outcome determinative way, the courts will stand in. Now you may agree, you may disagree with the outcomes in Bush v. Gore, but it was an interesting doctrinal development that the court had to come up with in 2000 as to why this matter was justiciable. What the Ohio federal courts, and particularly the Sixth Circuit, have done is they started to craft a new set of doctrines which protect voters as such, not as minority voters, not as Democratic voters or Republican voters, but they start questioning some of the deep vulnerabilities that our system has. And so the disagreement that Spencer and I play out, I don't want to go ahead into this, it's the latest issue of Harvard Law Review has the exchange between us. That's a prospect for taking advantage of the crisis. And the theorist is Rahm Emanuel, for those who don't recognize his name without the expletives. But but what that does is it starts to look beyond the immediacy of how it's done in a particular case and tries to think systematically about what are the core vulnerabilities of our election system, our democracy, and how do you address those systematically in the world in which we live today? Thank you.
So I first want to thank the panelists for not just their substantive comments, but for being remarkably on time, everybody within the constraints that we gave them. And we imposed those constraints because we want to have time for a little bit of discussion within the panel, and then in particular, we want to have a chance for you all to ask questions of people on the panel. So I feel like one role I should play as moderator is to press back a little bit against my concern always in these discussions about a kind of an echo chamber in which there are lots of assumptions taken for granted that would be challenged if there were more proponents of the other view kind of in the room. So let me just raise a question. I suppose I should direct it maybe to Dale, I think. About voter identification, which is such a big issue, and everybody in the room presumably is familiar with it. So I agree that there's not been any meaningful evidence marshaled of actual in-person voter fraud that rises to any level of significance in the United States. I also agree with what Sam alluded to, which is there's a very strong perception out there that is fairly widely shared that there is a concern about the integrity of the voting process in terms of whether there are people who are not eligible to vote who are showing up. If you look at the polling data, 75% of people, you know, regularly say in poll after poll over a number of years about this that they have that concern and that people should have to show identification. If you break that down by demographic groups, it's a majority of demographic groups, whichever way you cut it. It's a majority of Democrats who say that in these surveys. It's a majority of African Americans who say that in these surveys. And if there's a perception that's widely shared of threats to the integrity of the process, should democratic systems be able to respond to that, whether it's the perception of corruption with campaign finance or with respect to identification? Now, you know, in New York, we show up at the polls and we don't have to show any identification. We sign our name to the poll book, and supposedly the poll worker is going to look at the way we signed our name when we registered and compare the signature and make these decisions. In every other major democracy, people do show identifications. They show photo identifications. Partly that's because, as Sam said, they have national ID cards. So the question I want to pose, and I said maybe to Dale, is explain exactly why to the 75% of the people out there who think this is a common sense requirement. How can we have a system in which you're supposed to match signatures as a way of ensuring the integrity of the process? Is it identifications per se, photo identifications per se that is the objection? Are there forms of identification, including photo identification, that you would accept, you know, as an acceptable way of regulating the election process?
Thanks. There are a lot of questions in there, but let me try to address some of the pieces that you talked about. It's no surprise to me that there's majority support for photo ID laws, and it's no surprise to me that there's majority support for photo ID laws across demographic groups. So I think polling shows that, say, 60% of African Americans, for instance, support photo ID laws, even though there's been a lot of concern raised amongst voting rights advocates and civil rights organizations that these laws disproportionately affect voters of color. The reason it doesn't surprise me that most people and most people of all demographic groups support photo ID laws is that most people have photo ID cards, right? Most people of all races have photo ID cards. So when you ask these people, can you show a photo ID? Do you support showing a photo ID to vote? Most of them say, sure, because it's not a big burden for them. But it is a big burden for a substantial number of people. So we're litigating a case in Wisconsin over its voter ID law. We're actually in the midst of trial right now. And the evidence in that case has shown that over 60,000 voters in Milwaukee County alone do not have a government-issued photo ID card that would be deemed acceptable under the state's photo ID law. Now, we started the case last Monday by putting on a parade of some of our clients telling their stories about why they don't have ID, how they can't afford an ID, how some of the challenges they face in obtaining birth certificates to get ID, because even if the ID is nominally free, the birth certificate is not, and if you're out of state, if you were born out of state, it can be challenging to obtain a birth certificate, or if you're older, say, say, for example, you're African American, maybe you were born at a time when hospitals didn't take African American patients, maybe you were born at home to a midwife and you didn't get a birth certificate issued at all. We had clients who told stories like that. We had one client who told a story about a misspelling on his birth certificate, right? His name is Eddie Lee Holloway Jr. He told his story, and his birth certificate says Eddie Jr. Holloway. He was refused an ID by the state of Wisconsin because they said, you are not this person on the birth certificate. And he said, well, actually, in fact, I am. Can I correct my birth certificate? And they said, well, it's going to cost some money. Can't tell you exactly how much. $400 to $600 for this man to vote. when we asked the question on the stand, Mr. Holloway, do you have $400 to $600? His reply was, I don't have $400 to $600, right? He's not a well-off guy, right? Now, what was, I thought, really interesting, when we put our clients up on the stand, the lawyers for the state asked a series of questions, the same sort of boilerplate questions that they had thought of to ask our clients. Questions like, haven't you ever flown on a plane before? Answer, no. Haven't you ever traveled out of the country before? Answer, no. Right? Haven't you ever owned a car and driven one before? Well, I may have driven one once or twice, but no, never owned a car before. And I think it took about three witnesses before the state realized that they were starting to look like complete jerks. Because these things that we take for granted as middle class or upper middle class or even better, I can't speak for everyone in the room, are things that for a lot of people in this country, certainly not a majority, right? A minority of this country, right? But a sizable one, are experiences that they don't have access to, and they shouldn't be disenfranchised.
So can you just say, what kind of identification, if any, would you sort of view as legitimate form of identification?
Well,
given that we don't have national identity cards.
Well, maybe that is something that, you know, I mean, my brethren at the ACLU will probably have some issues with national identification cards. I mean, I think it would be different. I mean, I can't stand here and tell you which, you know, set of forms of ID we would, you know, support or not support. But let me just give you an example. We would say should be acceptable, right? Veterans Administration identification cards ought to be deemed acceptable, not acceptable for voting in Wisconsin, right? Purportedly because they don't have expiration dates, right? These are people who, you know, fought for our country and for our democracy and yet cannot use the ID cards issued by the VA in order to vote. I think that's a problem, just to give, you know, one example. And, you know, to the point that you make about public support for voter ID laws, one would think that if voter ID laws improve confidence in the system, that polling would show that, right? But if you look at polls, right? There was a great study by Ansel Behar and Nate Persily, who serves on the commission, that showed that voter confidence does not improve when you ask people for ID. In fact, it decreases because people start to think there's a problem.
Let me just close this off by just making the point that it's also true that when you have campaign finance reforms and you do various polls, there's no indication that regulation enhances public confidence in the process either. In fact, there's good evidence that it often decreases public confidence in the system because now you have people who are circumventing these rules. So, you know, it's a complicated issue how much public perception in that way is something we should rely on. I just brought up the polling data because, of course, within legislatures, the voter ID issue is a totally partisan issue. It's completely on party lines. Spencer, did you want to respond quickly to Sam, and then I'll open it up?
Let me respond to Sam and also to that question. I think that the ID issue is an important issue, but there are a lot of instances of local discrimination that are problematic. Sam talked about Ohio, and we've got both Bob and Ben, and they've got resources. They'll be in court, and they're going to attract the media in terms of their disputes. A lot of people in Reynolds County, though, who don't have the money for media, who don't have the money to bring lawsuits, and to me, that's a significant problem. That's not the only problem. Certainly the problems that Sam identifies are issues, and they're legitimate issues. I'm just saying that we shouldn't ignore this issue in Reynolds County. We've got a great system in terms of democracy, but our decentralized system means there's not a lot of transparency in local elections. We've got 3,000 different counties. If Ben does anything, Bob does anything, papers all over them, right? There's a massive disclosure, massive transparency. Every move they make, in terms of these local election officials, it's much easier to manipulate rules and disenfranchise people, and that's something that we should pay attention to.
Let me open it up for questions from the audience. While people are coming up, maybe I'll ask Bob and Ben. How do you deal with the hyper-decentralized way in which elections are run in the United States. I mean, it causes so many of these problems that we're talking about. It's amazing that even for national elections, for the highest offices in the country, we have individual counties with officials holding up in 2000 punch card ballots to the light to squint and see what counts as a vote, because there aren't uniform standards. So much of this process is down at the local level. I assume there's nothing you can directly do about that, but how much of a problem is that really for the core of these issues? And then either one of you?
Go ahead.
No, really, we do.
It is a problem, and the charge from the president was to prepare a set of best practices. So what we essentially will do, we'll provide a series of best practices. We're aware that one size doesn't fit all in terms of jurisdictions, but we will hopefully give a set of best practices. So if there is a problem in a jurisdiction, the people in that jurisdiction will be able to see the best practices and hold their officials accountable for not meeting them and hopefully address problems that way.
Want to say something?
Yeah, there are, that is absolutely correct, but that's what we're clearly going to try to do. And there are two things that I think give us some hope that this can work. Obviously, change doesn't take place in this country or in any other polity overnight. So there's going to be, obviously, there's an adjustment taking place in our electoral process, and it's painful, and in many respects, progress is obviously unsatisfactory. But in our tour of the country, there is both attachment to local tradition, that is to say the local jurisdictions are very used to doing things a certain way, and we keep on hearing about one size doesn't fit all and whatever. On the other hand, there's also a recognition that this is now viewed as a national problem, and that there is an expectation that there are certain standards that wherever an election might have to be administered, there's certain an expectation that those standards will have to be applied, and that jurisdictions will be scrutinized for failing to apply them. And so for that reason, I think it is a problem, but it, I think, is a problem as cumbersome as this multiplicity of jurisdiction makes it. It's a problem to which we actually can find over time, I wouldn't call it a solution, but we can certainly make progress on it.
Okay. Sir.
Hello, thank you.
If you could direct your question, by the way, to a particular person, that usually makes it easier, but go ahead. If you can't, we will.
Sure. So my question is in relation to the challenge, I think, has been particularly articulated by the two co-chairs, whereas it seems that sweeping election laws that actually have a substantive impact on enfranchising very large numbers of voters tend to need bipartisan support to be effective. And I know this from experience because I come from Australia, where we have automatic enrollment and compulsory voting. This occurred through bipartisanship because each party assumed that the other party would do worse under automatic enrollment and compulsory voting. One of those parties turned out to be wrong. And it seems that part of the history of bipartisan voting reform is both parties being optimistic about their chances under the new regime, and one of those parties turning out to be wrong. In a modern system where we have such excellent data predicting how individuals are going to vote, it seems that we don't have the capacity for at least one political party to be irrationally optimistic. So my question is, under those conditions, given that the game is zero sum and the actors are incredibly rational in terms of choosing voting systems that support their political purpose, can we really expect bipartisanship to return in the form of ideally a major national voting rights act, either reauthorization or an entirely new act?
Well, if I clip the last part of that question about the Voting Rights Act, maybe again I should ask Ben and Bob on bipartisanship. What are the prospects for any kind of electoral reform? How much of a stumbling block is this set of issues, which was beautifully raised by the questioner? Okay.
Well, obviously, just in the last year, I can identify one instance where Ben was irrationally optimistic.
It's good to be with my base. Thank you.
On the other hand, you know, I don't feel so sorry for Ben because he took me to Chicago and had me address the Republican National Lawyers Association. So, you know,
they loved you.
And they did. They did. They were. They confused me. They thought I was you, but they didn't. But in any event, listen, I think that there are going to be, this is going to sound maybe somewhat Pollyanna, but I think there's going to be there are many dimensions across which these kinds of fights rage, whether it's in campaign finance or it's in gerrymandering, areas where there's no question the stakes for partisans are very high in regulation of the political process, and there is no question that partisans are going to be weighing the advantages and disadvantages to them of a certain course of legislative activity or reform. No question. And that will be true in voting rights, for sure, at the federal and at the state level. I also believe that to some extent, ordinary politics, what actually happens in the body politics, starts to move partisans eventually. Not converging towards some happy middle where there's only agreement, but as I mentioned to you earlier, in our trips around the country, on some of these fundamental issues of public administration, delivering services to the voters within constitutional frameworks, constitutional and statutory frameworks for conducting elections, delivering services to the voters so that those who are eligible to vote can show up at the polls, cast their ballot, and have some confidence they can be counted. Maybe sometimes when the door is closed, but I think also evidence in the public hearings, you're hearing a lot more bipartisanship than listening to C-SPAN and watching the Senate chamber or the House chamber would suggest. And that's because of political practice. It's bubbling up from the bottom. And that's where, in my view, a lot of that bipartisanship is going to come, which is addressing voter demand, addressing changes in the demographics, addressing changes in the politics of the country.
I absolutely agree with that. Let me give you some examples of areas where, sort of to our surprise, we've actually found that both red and blue states are taking on certain reforms. Online registration is one. Mm-hmm. Secretaries of state in both Republican and Democratic states see the advantages of online registration. Cleaning up voter rolls is becoming much more accepted across the political spectrum. The ERIC project that Pew does, the Kansas Compact. Kansas Compact now has 27 states participating. ERIC is, I think, up to 7 or 8. Clear bipartisan agreement for different reasons, to be sure, but cleaner voter rolls is something that that people agree with. Early voting is being put into place by more and more states. The differences that we see tend to be regional. The Northeast doesn't like early voting. The Secretary of State of New Hampshire, who we're not really sure is an R or a D, was the most vociferous person telling us you can never, ever, ever have early voting because you need to show up at your polling place to do it. States out west, both Republican and Democrat, are increasing early voting options. On the need for new technology, there's sort of bipartisan agreement that the technology's fallen apart and you got to do something to fix it, and all the current machines are losing their shelf life. And there's great bipartisan agreement to be sure that military and overseas voters don't have impediments to voting. So I think those areas, I think much to our pleasure, exist and are real and are tangible.
Thank you very much.
Another question?
I like to pick up on my question is to pick up on your earlier point about national identity cards and whether it seems that we may be over time moving to a default position where we would have national identity cards. And I'd like to ask, maybe poll the panel, with perhaps the exception of the two members of the commission, whether they think that a national identity card would be the proper solution, and if so, what agency of the government would be responsible for policing and administering that, the Internal Revenue Service or perhaps the NSA?
Tax Exempt Bureau.
I don't know. Julie, do you want to start?
I mean, look, you know, I don't know. I'm not a big privacy person, but an ACLU person. I think that there could be a way to have a national ID card that was for everybody, that's free, everybody could use. But one thing I do want to say about this, the issue of an ID, is that there really are two separate questions. And just to tease them up for one second, one is whether or not any type of voter or photo ID is good for our democracy. You know, we can talk about it. Is it possible? Can we do it? Some places do it, and it seems to work for them. And, you know, I think that's a perfectly good conversation, and we should have it and think about it. The second is, which of these are in place either purposefully or have the effect to harm minority voters? I mean, look, it's not like we just started America last week, right? We didn't start this enterprise, you know, in the 80s or even, frankly, in the 60s. That this sort of enterprise that we're engaged in started a really long time ago, and it did start with slavery. And I hate to be the slavery person up here, but it's like, you know, maybe that's my job, but it's like, we have to, there is a part of this whole conversation, which I totally agree with, about our democracy that has to be looking out for people who historically and continue to be targets for marginalization. And it's not a Republican thing, and it's not a Democrat thing. It really is a thing that political parties can identify groups and then try and manipulate them for their advantage. So I actually am not trusting this sort of like, let the political parties fight it out and find a bipartisan solution, and then we'll all be okay, because we won't. Because the bottom line is that where a lot of the, when we had total Democratic control of the South, African Americans got screwed. Where we have total Republican control of some places, African Americans and Latinos, Texas, are getting screwed. So it isn't about political party. It is about rights. And we do not have a fundamental right to vote in the Constitution, which we should, but we do have a right to non-discrimination based on race in the Constitution. That's my view.
Larry?
So I want to probe the panel a little bit, particularly on Sam's point. And let me address my question to Mr. Ho, but anybody can deal with it. In your case, you put on a number of witnesses who were minority witnesses who didn't have the financial wherewithal to have IDs, to easily procure IDs. If I were the Attorney General of the state opposing you, would my tactic be to put on a bunch of, you'll pardon the expression, put a white bunch of white hillbillies who also don't have the wherewithal and say, no disparate impact, therefore you lose? And isn't that why we need Sam's analysis?
Well, actually, we bring equal protection claims in our case too, not just Voting Rights Act discrimination claims. And our lead plaintiff in the case is an older white woman, 86 years old, Ruth L. Frank, elected member of her village board, no birth certificate, right? Elected official, no birth certificate, no ID. Right? So I agree, I guess, with the point that these issues, you know, of access, apart from the local issues that I think Spencer was talking about very appropriately, do cut across racial lines. And maybe there are ways of addressing those issues with race-neutral legal theories. But the fact is, right? The voter ID issue, for instance, does disproportionately affect people of color. Now, if the state could disprove that, then yes, they would not. We would not be able to prevail under the Voting Rights Act. But that would, as I think you're alluding to, not insulate the state from potential other challenges and other just burdens on the right to vote.
I'm sorry that we actually are going to have to wrap things up here. It's very unfortunate. There's so much knowledge here that we could convey. I know Bob and Ben, I just want to say in closing, you can't tell us anything about what the commission is actually going to do, but given the Disney presence in our conversation and on your commission, can you tell us if one of the recommendations to make the voting experience better will be that we'll have a Mickey Mouse at every polling place or a Donald Duck or something like that?
I think the answer is no.
Actually, the Disney representative told a group of election officials that he was shocked, that there was no concession stand after.
And on that American note, close it off.